Today we are thinking about rethinking the U.S. military role in the Middle East, and this event is in part in celebration of the publication of this monograph. If you don't have a copy, pick one up on your way out. There are stacks of them out there. It's entitled U.S. Military Engagement in the Broader Middle East, and it's by Jim Jeffrey and Michael Eisenstadt. And since you came here to hear them and not me, and since you have their bios, we will get to it right away.
As one involved in some of the more spectacular alleged failures of American military involvement in the past decade plus in the Middle East, I have a interest in this. It's an interest that goes back to my first engagement, which was the 1973 Global Military Alert during the Yom Kippur War, which, as I argue in my paper, was a somewhat more successful military operation. But clearly, the issue of engagement militarily in the Middle East is a subject that keeps on coming back in a way that our engagement, including quite dangerous engagement with even more serious foes, the Chinese in the South China Sea, the Russians along the eastern flank of NATO right now, doesn't seem to compel the American public to focus on. Partially, it's the emotions that are raised by the terrorist threat. Partially, it's the conduct of operations over the past 10 to 15 years. But what I've tried to do is to take a step back and look at what's happened since World War II in this region. Why have we been there? And secondly, and to use a quote from Gideon, who was part of the inspiration for this, we had a discussion at a USIP forum about a year and a half ago with a lot of Clausewitz quotes flying back and forth. But durable political arrangements, that military action, even if the military action is successful in a military sense, doesn't really get you very much if you don't have a durable political arrangement. I think all of us can agree on that. The problem is, what's a durable political arrangement? And I try to tackle that a bit in the book, but it's something we can discuss here as well. Very briefly, since World War II, the United States has conducted operations in the Middle East, sometimes very actively, sometimes less so, but in the context of global strategy, which is to promote a liberal world order centered on an American-led collective security system, while not overly engaging the United States in long-term ground combat anywhere. Whenever we've done this, marching into North Korea, Vietnam, it hasn't turned out well in terms of either on the ground or in the American political system. So it's something that we try to do essentially on the cheap, keeping our defense budget always below 10% and usually below 5%, and again, keeping major combat to an absolute minimum. All in all, we've been pretty successful around the world. Major areas that were conflict zones 20, 30 years ago, such as Central America, Colombia, the Balkans, are now pretty quiet and, all in all, not doing badly, as we would define not doing badly in this order that we're at the center of. The Middle East is the gift that keeps on giving if you want chaos and disorder. We go back into places again and again and again. We're running our third coalition to fight in or against Iraq since 1990. We're in Afghanistan either in a continuation now of 15 years or a new campaign under Barack Obama to go back in and start attacking the Taliban again, which we've just begun doing again. So what's going on here? A couple of things. First of all, and Mike has done a fair amount of research on this in his paper, the region doesn't lend itself to the one-time fix the underlying security problems, and then it moves on and realizes the error of its ways and embraces a Western security and political system. Secondly, we've tried too hard particularly in recent years, to define durable political arrangements in a very broad, almost transcendental way. This has been particularly unsuccessful. In the past, both during the Cold War and in most of the first decade after the Cold War, significant military interventions in the Middle East, first of all, were based upon an overall strategy of containment, if you will, not only the Soviet Union until the end of the 1980s, but also regional wannabe hegemons, Iran, Iraq, at times Colonel Gaddafi, terrorist groups. Again, while using local allies, a structure of security relationships, bases, arms shipments, assistance to local actors, and only from time to time, American military intervention. All in all, it worked pretty well. A few times, not so well. Obviously, the attempt to rescue our hostages in Iran turned out badly. Beirut in 1983 and Somalia a decade later in 1993 turned out badly, in part because, and this is of great significance for what's happened over the past 15 years, we committed troops without a good end state. What is the durable political arrangement we're trying to seek? Absent that, interjecting ourselves into a very dynamic, very politicized, civil war-like situation in both countries, we found ourselves constantly changing our political goals to adjust to new situations on the ground and what we felt we could do and not do militarily. In both cases, we failed because we were dealing with people who really cared about their durable political arrangements or what they were hoping for, who were willing to take us on. And after we lost casualties, the American people basically decided this wasn't worth the candle. And out we came in both cases. Nonetheless, other military engagements, the containment of Iran, the containment of Iraq, the maintenance of our security relationships in the region, continued pretty successfully. And even today, despite all that's happened in the last 15 years, if you look at the region from Afghanistan to Iraq to Jordan to the Gulf to Egypt to Israel, you see a set of countries that are more or less allied with the United States, where we are operating in conjunction with their forces against ISIS, against al-Qaeda, to some degree in response to Iran. And so you can't say that this has been a total failure. In the larger sense, we've continued to do in the Middle East what we've done in other areas. Yet we've had to do it repeatedly through the use of force, and force is tricky for the United States. It's tricky for the American public, and it's tricky for any government. It's certainly tricky for this government right now. But certain things have gone wrong over the past 15 years, and again, they're tied not to our use of military force. And looking at the use of force over the past 70 years, I did an inventory of 41 military operations, some of which involved shooting, others, the global alert in 73 I mentioned, the arms flow to Israel, support for the Mujahideen against the Soviet Union in Afghanistan didn't involve shooting, or at least us shooting, but were still military operations, still a use of force, sometimes asymmetrical, sometimes very direct, 500,000 troops against Saddam in 1991, and by and large, militarily successful, and in terms of a durable political arrangement, successful in maintaining the alliance structures in the region and keeping the region out of the hands of one or another opponent or potential foe. So in that sense, we've been successful, including under both President Bush and President Obama. But we're in a very different situation these past 15 years, again, because there's a perception in America, and it's not entirely incorrect, that we have not been successful in our military engagements. most notably in Iraq after 2003, in Afghanistan, and to some degree against ISIS. And there are many who feel that we should be doing more against Iran in Syria and elsewhere. So there's considerable churn in the analytical community and the expert community on what should be going on. And in the American public, there is a feeling that we have become overly engaged in the Middle East. So why is this? From my perspective, it's because we did not continue to define durable political arrangements as status quo ante, as keeping the lid on the turmoil that is inherent in the Middle East, at least for the past century. But rather, we tried to transform the Middle East, first by military force in Iraq and Afghanistan, not only to try to transform those societies, but to use the transformation of those societies as a lever to move the entire region in that direction. We've moved away from this with President Obama, with the limited exception of his surge, such as it was in Afghanistan. But that's been replaced with a sense that we are overengaged in the Middle East, that our operations there, notably his operation in Libya and the surge in Afghanistan, were not successful, and that to the extent possible, we should retrench. Some of this was related to the pivot to Asia. Some of it is basically related to the sense in the administration that we're getting nowhere with these conflicts. The problem is that under the circumstances of a perceived American retrenchment, the situation appears to be growing worse with the fallout from Syria, with the Russian intervention in Syria, which we've tried very hard to avoid challenging, but as we saw earlier this week in the skies over southern Lebanon, southern Syria, that's hard to do because the Russians keep on pushing the envelope for reasons that are known best to Putin. And we have a rather conflicted relationship with Iran. We're supporting the Saudis and other Gulf states against quasi-Iranian-backed rebels in Yemen, while in other areas trying to reach out to Iran. So this approach doesn't seem to be generating more security in the region either. The problem is, and that's the conclusion that I came to in the paper, is that this region remains important to global security and thus to American security, and that the use of military force, if carefully managed with goals that make sense and don't involve transforming populations from the outside, we can continue to manage this very, very dangerous situation. I'll end with a quote from Barack Obama. The United States of America has helped underwrite global security for more than six decades with the blood of our citizens and the force of our arms. He said this when he received the Nobel Peace Prize in 2009. He probably wasn't thinking of the Middle East when he said that, but in fact, for the past 7 years, however reluctantly, he's been continuing to do just that in that region. Thank you very much.
Thank you all for being here, and thank you, Jim and Gideon and Patrick. It's an honor to be on this panel with you guys. Let me just start off with saying what my presentation is not about. This is not about what our military strategy in the region should be, but it's about how to think about U.S. Military strategy and the use of the military instrument in our policy in the region. And I'll just start with just a few points. My point of departure is that I believe, and this is something which I discussed in greater length in the piece, we still have vital interests in the Middle East that require us to remain militarily engaged there. There's oil, even if it's less important for us, it's still important for many of our allies who are major trade partners, and therefore our economy depends on their economic well-being. The Middle East is an exporter of instability and violent extremism, And for that reason, which I'll explain a little bit more in a moment, makes it very important for us. There's the issue of proliferation and then the security of Israel and our Arab allies. So if I was to summarize the experience of recent years, why we need to remain engaged in the region is that, first, what happens in the Middle East doesn't stay in the Middle East. And secondly, if you don't visit the Middle East will visit you. And we've seen this increasingly in recent years, where in the past, the West tried to export its security frameworks, such as, you know, NATO's Mediterranean security dialogue with the Middle East. But instead, what we've seen is that the Middle East has exported its insecurity to the West. And in a very real sense, the Middle East is, in a sense, moving west and north. While the UK maybe is leaving the EU, we're seeing a growing number of Middle Easterners moving to the EU. So the Middle East is moving west and north, and increasingly we have to deal with the problems of the region as a matter of necessity because of the impact those developments have on the politics of our allies in Europe. We're seeing with the revival of right-wing parties due to the influx of refugees and terrorism, which could potentially have a dramatic impact on Russian influence there, and eventually perhaps on our own politics. So what's the problem? The problem is that while we, as Jim has really done a nice job in his piece of showing, while we were very adept and effective at dealing with regional crises that involved conventional conflicts in the past, such as in 56 and 67 and 73, and Iraq in 91, we've been much less effective in dealing with more recent challenges involving insurgencies, proxy warfare, and state failure. And we've not proven equal to the task in dealing with these challenges. But the problem is, these are the challenges of the future, increasingly so. The challenges of today in the Middle East and the challenges of the future. And because we still have vital interests engaged in the Middle East, we have to find a way to operate more effectively there to deal with the problems of the region. And as a result, we need to reassess the way that we think, organize, and act militarily in the region so that we can more effectively and better navigate this environment, this very chaotic and challenging environment, than we have in the last 15 years. So if I was to say the first thing we need to do in order to be more effective, we have to understand what we call in the military the operational environment, which basically has to do with everything that affects your military operations. But in the case of the region, I would say it's specifically cultural and political features of the environment. In particular, you have, of course, the influence of Islam and nationalism, the impact of tribalism on the political culture. But more than anything else, I think it has to do with the state system, which is influenced by these factors. Because the Middle East is, as Henry Kissinger has said, a pre-Westphalian state system. In other words, states incessantly meddle in the affairs of each other. We saw this. This is something which goes back to the 50s and the 60s, and you look what Nasser did in Yemen and the two Ba'ath parties ruling in Syria and Iraq, constantly intervening in each other's affairs. So this is nothing new, and we're seeing it more than ever today, though, with also Iran now added to the mix. Plus, we've also seen, historically, the Middle East has been characterized by a high degree of great power penetration because of its geographic location and the presence of oil there. And as a result, military victors in the region were often thwarted in their efforts to consolidate their victories and to transform them into lasting political achievements by other countries who were always trying to kind of thwart their successes by, undermining or working against them or bandwagoning against them. So what are the implications of this operational environment in terms of how we operate in the region? First of all, even decisive victories are often ephemeral and set loose forces which often prove their undoing. And wars often bear the seeds of future conflicts. And I'll give you a few examples. 1967 Arab-Israeli War, a very decisive Israeli victory. But within a year and a half, Egypt was again at war with Israel because the Soviets replaced Egypt's losses. You had also at that time the rise of the Palestinian national movement and the rise of the PLO, which in its own way gave rise eventually a couple years later to the Jordanian Civil War and then eventually the Lebanese Civil War. In 73, you had a war which was fought to a standoff and which one of its positive achievements was the Egyptian-Israeli peace treaty, but also the quadrupling of oil prices which allowed Iraq to dramatically increase its military and enable the invasion of Iran in 1980. And then in 1991, U.S. victory in Kuwait, which was, and the expulsion of Iraqi forces from there, which was a dramatic American success of arms. But the fact that the U.S. had to keep its forces in the region to contain Iraq helped lead to sanctions fatigue, anti-Americanism, and eventually the U.S. presence in Saudi Arabia helped contribute to the rise of al-Qaeda, and which is a challenge we're still dealing with today. Now, so let me just say, despite all these negative aspects of intervention, intervention will sometimes also produce beneficial and lasting results, though I think this is often the exception rather than the rule, and the challenge is to be able to distinguish between situations which allow for this, for dramatic achievements, and others which are potential quagmires. We also have to, at least in the current situation, abandon what I call solutionism, the idea that somehow we can solve the region's problems. And we'll probably be in the management business of kind of managing the problems rather than solving them for the foreseeable future, at least for most of them. I would also say, though, that with regard to the nature of the operational environment, the challenges I mentioned work both ways. It works for us, but it also works for our adversaries. And likewise, so when our adversaries achieve gains, that always creates opportunities for us to undermine their achievements as well, if we're willing to seize those opportunities. Just a few other points of a number of items that I went into in greater detail in the book with regard to how the operational environment affects our performance of what I call critical national security tasks. For instance, one of them was counterterrorism. And I will just say that to a great extent, our policies in Syria and Iran, vis-a-vis Syria and Iran, have energized the very groups that we have been trying to defeat in our counterterror campaigns. So this is one of the major challenges we find, is aligning ways, means, and ends in our strategy. And we've not been very good with this. And actually, we've been doing a number of things which have been counterproductive to our military efforts in the region. Second, with regard to deterrence, compellence, and assurance, I would beg to differ with the president on the importance of credibility. I think our entire experience in the region shows how important credibility is. In international relations, it's the coin of the realm. And I give two examples to show, though, that it's actually much more complex than a lot of people think. With regard to Iran, for instance, Operation Earnest Will, our reflagging operations in the Gulf in the 80s, gave us credibility with regard to our commitment to freedom of navigation in the Gulf, which has stood us in good stead until today. So when the president and the defense secretary said in 2011 and 2012, vis-a-vis Iranian threats to close the Gulf in response to American sanctions, that would be a red line for us, I think they took it seriously. Although I have questions about whether the Iranians really actually intended to do so. But I think that was taken seriously because we've proven in the past we're willing to ensure freedom of navigation there. With regard to terrorism, on the other hand, our failure to respond to the Marine Barracks bombings and Khobar Towers, I think, has created a lack of credibility so that in 2011, to the point that Iran even considered conducting a terrorist attack in Washington. So with the same country, in two different arenas, I think we had different kind of degrees of credibility. But you have to look at each history, the culture, and politics has an important role in navigating successfully when it comes to these factors. Security force assistance. I'll just say that, and this has to do with training and equip missions and the like, our approach needs to be tailored to the operational needs and culture of our partners. I think one of the reasons we've been failing to some extent, especially in Iraq, is we've tried to create miniature versions of the U.S. military. And we try to impose on them a model which is not appropriate culturally. And I'm not going to go into it now because I don't really have the time. We could go into this more in Q&A. But there's other factors as well, but I think that's a major factor. And then finally, information activities. This is the main line of operation for many of our adversaries, whether it be Iran or ISIL or al-Qaeda. And therefore, it needs to be our main line of effort. And if you look in the anti-ISIL campaign, it's number 6. Of our 9 lines of operation. So I believe that information activities need to be receive much more attention and many more resources than they do. Because if perception is reality, shouldn't you be trying to put a lot more effort into changing the perceptions of people abroad in order to achieve your goals? So anyhow, what are the implications of the operational environment as I described before for the U.S. way of war in the Middle East? First of all, I think our military vocabulary and mental models are still too much influenced by conventional warfare paradigms. And again, I think by and large, at least in this part of the world, the age of large-scale major conventional conflicts by and large is gone, although we still have to be ready for that possibility. So when the president talks about degrading and ultimately destroying ISIL, it's not clear to me what destroy means. Destroy is a doctrinal term, and if you look it up, the definition is appropriate for military systems and pieces of equipment. It's not relevant to a dispersed and distributed network or organization or a proto-state like ISIL. We talk about exit strategies, although that's not a doctrinal term. It's a popular term. But what does exit strategies mean in a conflict in which there is no end in sight, at least in this part of the world, when you talk about the kind of regional conflict system that has emerged with conflicts in Iraq and Syria and Libya? And when we talk in the military event states, what does that mean in an era of kind of protracted conflicts? So our language is not quite right. Our mental models are not right because our preferred way of war has always involved the rapid destruction of the enemy through high-tech firepower and overwhelming force. That worked in Iraq against Iraq in 91. I would argue that in Iraq and Afghanistan in 2001 and 2003, that was actually our downfall because by causing the rapid collapse of the enemy and not his defeat in detail, he actually went to ground and came back as an insurgent. So our approach was is what Rumsfeld used to call catastrophic success. But we have to adjust our way of war to dealing with networks and non-state actors. And I would argue, actually, we've been doing a good job on an ad hoc basis in Iraq in the last few years, maybe not as quickly, not acting as quickly as we needed to and as vigorously as we needed to. But we need to institutionalize the ad hoc approaches we've developed in the last few years as we move forward. Likewise, in this environment, we have to avoid what is a typically American binary way of thinking about war and peace, friends and enemies, victory and defeat, and regular and irregular conflicts, because a lot of these are kind of merged. And there's a term which is making which is becoming increasingly popular, gray zone conflicts, which I think kind of describe this murkiness. We have to abandon our preference for tactical and technological solutions. As embodied in DOD's third offset strategy, Americans tend to worship at the altar of technology, but while technology is important, good geostrategic instincts and political and cultural savvy, I think, are even more important for succeeding in this part of the world. We need a light footprint approach, which is something which the Obama administration has been pursuing, although I would argue, again, with insufficient alacrity and insufficient aggressiveness. But I think this is made necessary not only by the operational environment, but by domestic opinion and the fact that we're having growing pressures overseas and other parts of the world that we have to maintain our agility to deal with crises, perhaps in Europe or in East Asia, and therefore it's important not to be bogged down with major operations in the Middle East. But on the other hand, we can't afford to walk away, and we need to be engaged. And we need to be engaged sufficiently to maintain momentum against groups like ISIL and Al-Qaeda and to deter countries like Iran and to bring along our partners and allies. Another point is that you can't compensate for geopolitical missteps with tactical virtuosity, which is, I think, a lot of what we've been trying to do in recent years. And we see, as a result of, I think, our policies, and I'll be wrapping up, our policies in Iraq and Syria and elsewhere, our answer is to give our allies more arms. But a lot of the steps we've been taking have had geopolitical consequences which have had adverse impact, I believe, for our interests and our allies' interests. And again, doubling down by beefing up our allies' capabilities or our capabilities is really can't compensate for poor geopolitical judgment. I mentioned information activities are decisive, so I'll leave it at that. I just want to mention that again. I can't emphasize how important information activities are, but it's not only a matter of what you say, it's also what you do, because there's an old saw for strategic communication. Strategic communication is 20% words and 80% action. And our actions and our words have worked across purposes recently. And the final point I made is, in the end, you can't avoid transformational agendas, either in the United States or overseas. In order to succeed in the Middle East, we have to change our strategic culture and our way of war and our way of thinking about how we use the military instrument. In the Middle East, I think it's the political culture of many of the areas that we're intervening in, which have led to the conflicts and the civil wars and the failed states, which has to change. So there is no avoiding a transformational agenda when it comes to the political culture. How to achieve that? I don't have a very good idea. Wars sometimes are change agents in this regard, but and sometimes it's also a matter of transformational leaders, or it's a matter of social engineering as a result of social and educational reforms. But I believe that in order to deal with the problems that the Middle East is now facing, there is no substitute for changing the political culture there. And again, I'm not sure we're very good at that. That's something that has to be organic, and how that will happen, I have no idea. But maybe we could discuss about that. Maybe the other panelists have an idea. So thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm Gideon Rose, editor of Foreign Affairs, and I'm here as the sort of outside grader. And let me just say that this is a really superb piece of work. Pat, I've followed the Washington Institute since before it was born. I was an intern for Martin when he was still at AIPAC, before he left to found YNAP. And I've followed it, obviously, very closely over the years. And I can truly say that this book is in the best traditions of the last several decades of YNAP's work. It is not just authoritative, it's intellectually serious, it's dispassionate, it's knowledgeable, and it really is constructive in the best sense. So I really congratulate not just Jim and Mike, but you and Rob and everybody at YNAP for producing it. I think that it also helps set up the debate that is going to play out in the early stages of the next administration. Let me say a couple of things about the book itself and then turn to that larger debate and how this fits into that. The book, what makes the book so good is the fact that it situates the current choices we face in a broader theoretical, historical, and functional context. So Jim's introduction first section that puts it in the context of U.S. foreign policy more generally over the post-war era is exactly right, because the place to start is the big global macro framework. And I think his discussion of how the liberal order has generally worked and how the Middle East has fit into it is absolutely correct and very useful and the proper way to start. I would make two little tweaks to that, which is, although I agree entirely that the post-war era has been marked by this American attempt to create and sustain and manage a global liberal order, I think the Middle East, and that you should see the Middle East's U.S. relations with the Middle East as part of that and in that context, there's two things that differentiate the U.S. role in the Middle East from the way it dealt with other parts of the world with regard to that liberal order. The first is that during the Cold War, the U.S. The Middle East was a zone of ideological and regional proxy conflict in the Cold War. And so while there were areas like East Asia or Europe that were core concerns of the order, core protectorate, almost colonies of the U.S. and building blocks of the order, the Middle East was more of an arena for proxy conflict and ideological conflict in the broader world. So it was sort of not quite fully in the order and was fought over and contested. And second, that the key thing that led us to being ever more involved was the Middle East's role essentially as the gas station for the order. The order was not just a political one, it was also an economic one, and the modern world economy runs on hydrocarbon resources. Most of those things were, dead dinosaurs and plants stuck under the Middle East. And the extent to which the Middle East's energy resources needed to be secured, needed to flow out of the Middle East to allow, at reasonable prices, to allow the order to function properly was crucial. And that was what ultimately kept drawing the U.S. and outside powers further in as an economic necessity. The key turning point happens in the, as he talks about, in the sort of essentially late 70s or 70s through the late 80s, because a couple of things happen. One, after the British withdraw and we come in to fully stabilize the situation, we take on an ever more significant role, with the Carter Doctrine being the formal acknowledgement of that. And second, when the Cold War ends, essentially, you end up with a new environment. And this brings me to the sort of contemporary era, because I think the Cold War era, we're essentially on the cusp of the third significant period, broadly speaking, in the post-war era. There was the Cold War, there was the post-Cold War era, and essentially we're now embarking on the post-post-Cold War era, or whatever it is you may want to call it, because the Clinton years, the Bush years, and the Obama years, which essentially are a coda to wrap up or walk away from the Bush years, form a sort of trio. And we're really now starting to look at the world post those. And what happened in that post-Cold War era was that the Cold War was no longer dominant. Oil was still crucial, and energy was still crucial. And there was this burst of U.S. power and optimism and confidence that enabled us to think in terms of the solutionism that was talked about before. And so you had not only solutionism in the Middle East peace process in the 90s, but you had a hope that the broader region would sort of evolve in a positive way. And then terrorism with 9/11 gets added. And then you have the Bush administration's response to that with the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, and a transformational agenda to hopefully do a solutionism in that regard as well. That didn't turn out so well. The Obama administration comes in with a mandate to walk away that it sees, and a practical argument to sort of retrench. It basically does so. And it doesn't solve the problem, but it does walk away a little bit. So now you have this situation in which the fundamental questions of how involved the U.S. should be in the Middle East, and what it should care about, and what it should do about it, and what it can do about it, are back in play. And this is where I think a lot of the stuff that Mike talks about in his sections come in, because one of the crucial things in Mike's section of the book is his discussion of the whole range of military instruments and how they may or may not link up to larger strategic goals and political goals. And the idea that sort of completely walking away isn't possible, nor is large-scale conventional war with a goal to sort of fix the problem and solve it an answer, I think are both indisputably correct. And so his conclusion that we want to basically rely on or become more aware of the utility of military operations short of large-scale conventional war, as it were, that are designed to manage and stabilize an ongoing situation. The way he puts it, the challenge is to fashion a light footprint approach for the Middle East that is nonetheless robust enough to generate and sustain momentum against groups like IS and Al-Qaeda, deter adversaries like Iran, bring along allies and partners, and bolster or backstop diplomacy, but without a major investment of American blood and treasure. That's basically the challenge. How do you craft a sort of sustainable middle course that doesn't get you sucked in too much in ways that are domestically unsustainable, or you know, that you just are hemorrhaging blood and treasure, but that you don't walk away so much that the problems fester, the petri dish grows lots of bad things, and that then come back and bite you elsewhere. That's the basic challenge. What's, I think, taking place now, what I hope is taking place now, is the beginning of a real debate on how we do this and how much we need to do this. Because a number of the traditional verities of the U.S. role in the Middle East are changing or have changed. So I think this book, which is excellent, should be read in conjunction with a few other things that are have been published recently. Ray Takei and Steve Simon did a nice book called The Pragmatic Superpower, which just came out, that basically is a survey of U.S. interventions in the Middle East during the Cold War. It's a good complement to this because it basically fleshes out the details of a lot of the stuff that Mike and Jim are talking about in the history. But it also sets up the question, which is, well, if that was all done in part because the Cold War was this great the Middle East was an arena in the Cold War, and we had to be involved in all these various coups and operations and proxy fights and domestic things in the Middle East because of the Cold War, if there's no more Cold War, why do we still need to be doing this? And that's a fundamentally interesting question. The book doesn't really have a good conclusion, in part possibly because the authors disagree on this. And I think there are some interesting new pieces out in Foreign Affairs recently that address this. Jonathan Stevenson and Steve Simon have a piece in the fall that basically takes that analysis further, which essentially says, you know what, the Obama administration is on target because the Middle East is a mess and we don't need to be there anymore as much as we used to. And so the retrenchment makes sense because staying and getting more involved wouldn't do much good and it would just cost us more. Ken Pollack has made the case that, look, this kind of half retrenchment that we've been doing is enough to make problems worse without actually insulating us from their consequences. And so we may need to go either further out towards the kind of offshore balancing that you know, the Mearsheimer and Walt types would like, that Mike disagrees strongly with in the book here, or go back in some more significant way to try to stabilize or try to manage or try to keep the problems. I would say that Mike's suggestion is sort of sketching the way towards not a full Pollack, but a half Pollack, that's a sort of a managing the situation in a more active way. More than Obama, but less than Bush.
A poor man's Pollack.
A poor man's Pollack. Pollack light. A light footprint Pollack. But I think, you know, it's interesting. Two things that I would say that the book didn't get into, I mean, it couldn't get into everything, but that should be discussed in this kind of context are energy and time frame. And what I mean by that is after the Cold War rationale faded for U.S. involvement in the Middle East, the energy rationale continued, and terrorism was added to it. And there was also a positive hope that maybe U.S. intervention diplomatically and so forth could midwife an end to the Arab-Israeli conflict, bring peace to the region, maybe even transform under the Bush years the Arab societies or the region in a positive way. Very few people believe any of the positive goals anymore, either on the Arab-Israeli front or the domestic transformation of the Arab countries front. The terrorism issue obviously is real and serious and ongoing, but just how much that's connected to U.S. Middle East policy, if your major terrorist attacks at home are by self-radicalized or at best quite indirectly radicalized locals rather than direct operatives, how much your actual operations in the Middle East will do to address Orlando or San Bernardino or whatever is not at all clear. And so the interesting question comes about, well, what about that energy thing? Because in an era of fracking and in an era of increasing oil gluts and increasing technological possibilities for renewables, over time, are we seeing a future? Can we see not to an ongoing future in which the Middle East will be a permanent albatross that we need to stabilize and bear the burden of stabilizing, but will it just be another decade or two, or you know, or maybe three, before we can forget about this region and let it sink back into the obscurity of American policy that it occupied prior to the second quarter of this century? So the question of energy resources and time frame, and let me explain what I mean by this very simply. In the 90s, in the post-Cold War era, early post-Cold War era, you could make a case. The Middle East was crucially important to the global economy and very important for global security. It was going to be that way for several decades. And it was messed up domestically. And so a major American push to try to transform the region, stabilize it, and improve it. Sort of the way we taking over the Middle East as a condominium in a well-intentioned, benign, you know, sort of pseudo empire by invitation or indirect imperialism, whatever. Something along the lines of what we did with East Asia and Europe might actually be possible. And what we learned, I would say, over the last generation was it's a hell of a lot tougher to transform than we thought. We should have known this. It was dramatically harder than the major optimists felt, but it was even harder than the moderate pessimists felt. I mean, this is about as recalcitrant material for transformation. Even the things we thought were making progress on, like Arab-Israeli stuff, didn't turn out to be all that tractable. So now, after a generation of blood and treasure and diplomatic energy spent with extraordinarily little to show for it, and a domestic political base that wants nothing to do with major involvement in the region, we have to face the question of, well, we can't really transform it, and we're not going to spend a whole lot of money and effort to do it. So then the question becomes, how long do we actually have to deal with this region? How long do we have to care about the Middle East? And how much do we have to care about the Middle East? There are a whole lot of regions around the world that have great problems that we don't give a damn about. There are other regions that we care about, but the problems aren't that major. The Middle East is, I would say, right now, the region that is the one we care about the most, whose problems are the most intractable. And so that's the root of the dilemma that this book addresses. What the hell do we do with a region which we care about deeply and whose consequences of the events there affect us, but we just don't really know or have the tools to affect the dramatic sources of those problems? And one answer may be, and this is actually something that, as alien as it is to sort of Wynep's founding philosophy and the general consensus there, the American people are basically sending a pretty clear message. You know what? If we don't have to deal all that directly with the Middle East, it's not that big a deal. Although they don't want to be hit with terrorist attacks and they don't want giant problems and they can be mobilized in specific things, they're more than happy, far more than happy than most of the Washington foreign policy elite, and certainly the Washington elite dealing with the Middle East, to not play the kind of ongoing major direct role, not even in transforming, but even in stabilizing along the ways that sort of Mike and Jim would want. And I think this is going to be a very interesting discussion that is going to play out over the next few years, because once the passions of the Obama years have faded a little bit, once the after effects of Iraq and the debacle of Iraq and the debacle of the withdrawal from Iraq are all sufficiently in the rearview mirror that it can be, okay, what do we do now is the topic, rather than fighting over who was responsible for whatever, then the question becomes, okay, how much do you actually have to get to involve? How much involved do you have to get? Over what time frame? And what are the tools you can do? I think a lot of what Mike says is valid in terms of his suggestions. I'm not entirely sure. Okay, I'll wrap it up. Not entirely sure that I see all the upsides for some of the things like information operations. I mean, in a conspiracy-ridden era in which there's tons of media, I don't see how you can do any kind of information operations successfully these days, because there's just too much noise out there, separating signal from noise, and the locals are going to, you know, they're not going to be able to hear the messages you're sending anyway, and if they would hear them, they would misinterpret them. So I just don't buy the information op stuff. But the questions of, do we need to be involved? In what ways? For what purposes? And for how long? I think are absolutely central, and especially as technology in the energy industry and other kinds of factors make the Middle East less geostrategically central than it was, it's going to be an interesting debate. And the last thing I would say about this is there's a little bit in Mike's chapter about how badly the current administration has done in sort of walking away from its allies and bolstering Iran with the deal and things like that. And I think that I understand where that's coming from, and I know there are people who feel that way, and I know certainly our local Sunni allies feel that way. But I wonder if some of the animus or some of the passion there and some of the anti-Iran stuff that is quite taken for granted here really is a bit backward looking. And what I mean by that is if you are indeed moving away a little bit, and if you are indeed dissatisfied with the performance in a whole range of ways with your various local allies, I put that in quotes because it's not clear, or friends, allies, it's not clear just how friendly or how allied they actually are, and they're certainly dysfunctional across the board. Given that, moving towards some kind of local balance, moving towards some kind of situation in which you're not moving towards Iranian hegemony, but you're creating a little more of a, you're pausing the Iranian nuclear program while creating enough of a sort of balance that you can walk away from a little bit from the region, which may be the ultimate outcome. We don't choose between India and Pakistan, but we try to sort of be on decent terms with both while keeping their conflict at bay. Could you evolve in the Middle East to where you don't necessarily choose between Iran and Saudi Arabia eventually, whereas you have sort of relations with each while keeping their conflict sort of simmering rather than boiling over? Might that be a strategy for an ultimate longer-term management in a sustainable way of the local balance? I don't know. But I would say that it's clear to me that what we've had in the last several years and even the last several generations isn't going to be the model for the future. And I think this book is a great start and setup for the discussion that we're going to have going forward. Thank you.
By the way, Gideon has to leave a little early, so when you see him getting up and walking out at 1:50, know that it's because he's offended at the question you've asked and how silly it is, and not because of this phony excuse he's got of another appointment or two. Gentlemen, if I understand you correctly, what you're telling us is that we can't expect solutions in this part of the world. Don't look for solutionism. Look for modest results. And we should not take the approach of fight or flight, that we have to be involved on a modest scale. Well, the cynic in me says that what you are recommending is that we get involved in quagmires. No clear solution, continuing involvement. We can't easily get out. Why am I wrong?
I don't think you're wrong. That's what Mike's advocating. I'm advocating the lighter, still version of that, which is more like the Obama one, which is not so much involvement in quagmires as just enough to keep the quagmires from becoming, you know, giant catastrophes. And accepting that they are indeed quagmires and bearing up under it. But I'll let Mike answer yours.
So quagmire light.
Yeah.
Well, look, as I said in my opening comments, that if you don't visit the Middle East, it visits you. So the challenge is finding the right balance. On the one hand, maintaining sufficient presence in order to, and I'm not arguing for containment, and just management. I think it's very important for us to be sufficiently involved to actively be rolling back groups like ISIL and AQ, but in a way that does not require a major U.S. ground presence. One of the main arguments I put forward in the piece is that when in Rome, do as the Romans do kind of argument, is that we have to be much more adept at working with local partners and I know proxies, and I know a lot of our partners are very problematic in that regard. In this administration, I think would have liked to have done more had our partners been more effective. One of the arguments I'm making is, in part, our politics have complicated that effort because our politics have strengthened our enemies and demoralized our friends. And part of it is a technical argument that we're not going about it perhaps the right way, and we're doing things that don't work within that cultural milieu. So I am, and I believe this is the best way to avoid quagmire because, again, having a training presence on the ground, relying on standoff firepower, whether it be ground-based or air-based, is much better than having infantrymen in contact. Now, in terms of, you know, when is this an open-ended conflict? Well, yeah, because the Middle East ain't going anywhere, and the problems that are roiling through large parts of the region, let's say, you know, one of the things we have to do is ensure that our allies who remain stable, you know, the Jordanians and the Israelis and the Gulf countries, don't succumb to these groups. So all the more reason we have to be involved there, because if you think it's bad now, we may not have had hit the high water mark. So we have to be grateful for what we still have and work to make sure that that doesn't come undone. So I'm arguing for, I don't think the quagmire term is very helpful, because I'm arguing for a level of involvement that, again, doesn't involve a large amount of the expenditure of large amounts of blood. Treasure, certainly nowhere near what we spent in Iraq and Afghanistan, but I think the treasure is better spent up front preventing worse things from happening than dealing with the aftermath. So,
can I take a two-finger on that just to pose a question to these two, both of them?
Sure.
Take a very specific case. It's a minor one, but it's relevant because it gets to the heart of the question that Pat just raised. Take Yemen, okay? Our allies, enemies, are fighting a proxy civil war there. The local, it's a giant chaos. It's clearly been not a success for American policy. Do we really care all that much about what's happening in Yemen? And is there, even if we do, is there something significant that we can and should do about Yemen on the ground that we're not doing? Or is this something in which we say we have partners and allies and frenemies and whatever who are all involved in their own squabbles and battles, all incompetent and all vicious? And, if they want to fight each other and the locals are all dysfunctional as well, why do we need to be involved or to care greatly about Yemen? And why can't we just say, you know what, this is not ours. If you guys want to fight, we're out of here.
I'll take that on. When you said one specific example, I was horrified you would say Libya in 2011, because I was prepared to say, in anything I want to discuss today, the one outlier that I will not talk about is the whole Libyan thing. But you picked the other one. Here's why I would say a economy of force operation in Yemen, even if it drags on, is not a quagmire. My definition of a quagmire may be different than yours and Patrick's.
What do you mean by an economy of force operation?
An economy of force operation is when we're not getting a lot of Americans killed. And we're not costing a lot of money, but we're having an effect on the ground. Why are we in Yemen? We're in Yemen because of two things. First of all, the president, perhaps wisely, perhaps not, has decided he's not going to get engaged against Iran and friends in Syria. But on the other hand, at least once a week, even the president, but more importantly, a lot of allies that he has to care about, would challenge your extraordinarily on-target presentation of the if-or situation. Is Saudi Arabia, Iran, a Pakistan, India, or a Turkey, Greece, going back a few decades, or is it something different? My argument would be not the people of the region believe, and to some degree I believe, that it is something different, that you can't share the region with somebody who wants to be a hegemon in the region and thus wants to shift the balance of forces. The Saudi viewpoint, however, and we could, spill ink that would fill this room on the problems of Saudi Arabia and its friends who are fighting there, although I have to say the Emirates are actually doing pretty well. It may not wind up being a stalemate, thanks to them. But their viewpoint is, hey, Iran is in Yemen, Syria, Lebanon, Iraq, and is trying to get into Bahrain and is getting into Afghanistan. All of those are primarily, or at least large plurality, Sunni areas, and all but Afghanistan are Arab areas, and none of them are Persian areas. That walks and talks and smells and quacks like a hegemonic country on the march. And what do you do with hegemonic countries on the march, be they Milosevic, be they Saddam, be they Putin in Middle Europa? You try to find ways to contain, deter, and push back against them. That's what's going on in Yemen. Yemen is, from that context, now that is a debatable position. But if you accept my argument, The same thing happens with South Korea. You know the history because it's in your book. What did Dean Acheson say in January of 1950 about Korea? It's on the other side of that line. That's yours. It isn't important. And it wasn't very important, but it turned out to be very important. So I'll rest my case.
Well, I would just say the key thing there is, and this is exactly the question with analogies, right, which is there's that is absolutely correct. And Korea turned out to be not only worth fighting for, but something he shouldn't have included from the defense perimeter. But North Korea was a bridge too far. Vietnam was a bridge too far because you weren't going to actually be able to do it. And so the question of what sorts of things we should or should not fight for, I think you raise a plausible argument. I guess what the lesson I draw from history is that what Kennan or Gaddis talked about is asymmetrical containment works a little better than symmetrical containment in the sense that just because the other guy wants to fight for it doesn't necessarily mean it's something you should fight for if it doesn't have any intrinsic value of significance.
But we have other people fighting for us in out there. The problem with Vietnam and Korea, or North Korea, I should say, is between the two of them, we lost just short of 100,000 American lives and millions of other allies and enemies died too. So Yemen's a totally different level.
I could just quickly jump in very, very quickly. I think also Yemen shows the dangers of disengagement because previously our Gulf allies would not act outside of security frameworks created by the U.S. And that's one of the problems of the last few years since 2011. They feel that there no longer is an American security framework for them to act within. So they do some of their own. They do things that sometimes are very harmful to our interest, whether it be in Syria. Yemen, I'll leave it whether you know open as in that regard. But our ability to influence their choices would be greater if we have a greater degree of involvement. And finally, just one point on the Iran thing. I'm just simply arguing. I never argued against the idea of a JCPOA, although I wasn't happy with the final form it took. But you know, I think it's a great idea if we could have got a diplomatic agreement with Iran that. Foreclose the nuclear option while at the same time pushing back. And that's the problem. That's what I'm arguing for. In the Middle East, everybody always operates on two, if not three, tracks. And we're very binary, that if we're making nice to Iran, we can't push back against them in Syria. And I'd argue we'd be much more effective and we would have done a better job with keeping our allies, kind of by our side if we had, while we're negotiating with them, also pushed back in Syria, perhaps elsewhere. And that's what the Iranians did. They were not binary. They operated on several tracks against us. So, that's
well, before we turn to you for questions, I do have to say that 3 to 4 years ago, the one area which the U.S. government was asking the Institute to get most involved in looking at was Yemen, and the reason why is because they felt that AQAP was the single largest danger of terrorist attacks in the United States, and that we saw this in Detroit, and they felt that. And that's why the United States got militarily involved in Yemen, is because of the sense that we were going to be attacked out of Yemen. Anyway, let's have your questions. And let's start over here, please. And just stand up and speak loudly. We have mics here that work.
I tried. Lieutenant Colonel Stigashevolskan from the Polish embassy. Thank you for this fantastic discussion. I have a question particularly to you, Michael, when you said about imposing U.S. model on Iraqi forces and Iraqi military. What would you be your advice how to assist Iraqi military in this regard, not to impose it to take into account the cultural element of that? And what would be a further step, how to assist Syrian opposition? And possibly in future, this real military elements, taking into account this cultural dimension. That's my first question. The second one, what is your opinion? I'm asking all of you about this, how do you call it, descent channel message by 51 diplomats dealing with Syria, especially in this part of more muscular military posture, for us. In the Middle East?
In Iraq, we have two problems.
First of all, is that we have basically an approach, at least it seems to me, sitting on the outside 7,000 miles away, have a kind of an apolitical approach to security force assistance, that there's not much we can do to influence the choices of Prime Minister Abadi and perhaps get people who need to be fired. We were able to do that when we had 150,000 troops on the ground during the surge because we had leverage over the government. When we don't have large numbers of troops on the ground, we don't have influence, so we can't influence
choices with regard to perhaps corrupt individuals that need to be fired. So that's part of the problem. The other part has to do with culture. You know, if you look at the lessons learned literature and what American soldiers say is what's wrong with, you know, what's wrong with the Iraqi army, they don't have a one thing they always say is they don't have a strong non-commissioned officer corps. And they need to develop a strong non-commissioned officer corps like the U.S. Army. Well, you know, there's two very successful militaries in the world that succeeded despite not having strong NCO corps, the Soviet military and the Israeli military. So it's not that's not the only way to do things. And plus, in that cultural milieu, which is a very top-down organizational context, where a general has to sign off on things that in the U.S. military a lieutenant or a captain would sign off on, having a strong NCO corps is just not going to happen. It's not reinforced by the military culture or the general culture. So don't fight it. And there's lots of other things. You know, we try to teach them kind of tactics that are, you know, that emphasize initiative and decentralized execution. And again, in those militaries, it's all very top down. The Iraqis and the Egyptians before the 73 war and the Iraqis in the later phases of the Iran-Iraq war developed approaches which compensated for those weaknesses. And we should learn those lessons and try to apply them. So I don't know, maybe this is think tank nonsense, but that's my own thought on that. With the Syrians, the main problem we had with the Syrians, there were a lot of problems, it seems, with the train and equip effort. But the bottom line is, insurgency is an inherently political form of warfare. And if you're saying, we'll train you and equip you only if you fight the people we want you to fight and not who you want to fight, you're doomed. So we said, you got to sign this sheet of paper saying you're not going to fight the Assad regime. You just got to fight ISIL. Now, that'll work in the East where people who live in the East with ISIL, that's their main concern. But in other parts of the country, their main, you know. So our politics were not aligned with those of the opposition. And that's, you know, so don't even go there. And never mind the fact that we were always a day late and a dollar short with what we did and what we gave them, and we never gave them enough, and we sent people in without providing support. So anyhow, there was a lot of problems with that. So I'll leave it at that and let the others answer questions.
On the 51, their specific recommendation I didn't like very much, which was go and bomb Assad. I think that lost its validity back in 2013. But the idea is that they're reacting against is something that a lot of us have, and with the idea of better arming of the forces, because while we were telling one group through our special forces, you only fight Assad, the CIA in the South was telling another, and in the North as well, was telling another group, no, you're fine to go ahead and fight Assad. So there's, aside from a lot of confusion in the American position, we took a position that I think is politically correct, that we did not want to see Assad win this civil war for all kinds of reasons. But we have not done very much to try to stop him from moving towards what looks like a military victory. And this administration buys its own rationale, and I heard several versions of this just in the last week, that military success is no longer important in the 21st century. It's having Silicon Valley. It's being able to set up daycare centers. And all of this stuff is just self-defeating, so it doesn't matter. Therefore, they're not willing to take risks or assume costs, even on things that I think would have made more sense, such as Mike said, a better program to arm and equip the rebels, not to overthrow Assad and create chaos, but to basically make it clear that you have to have a negotiated settlement. Same thing with a safe zone in the north. The idea is to try to convince at least Russia, possibly Iran, that there may be an alternative way for them to get their key interest. Russia's key interest is not to lose a conflict and not to lose its bases. Iran's key interest is to have a bridge to Hezbollah. There are ways that can work out in a new construct in Syria that might end at least most of the violence. But it's not going to happen. That's the argument of these people. It's not going to happen if the United States keeps signing agreements with the Russians and you name the Alpine city, Geneva, Munich, Vienna. We've sat down with the Russians and done one or another variant of the same agreement in the past year, and the Russians keep on ignoring it and keep on moving to the offensive with Assad and with the Iranians. And so we look silly. We get more calls between Lavrov and Kerry. Kerry used to talk about Plan B. He doesn't even talk about the Plan B anymore, and I think that's why they were frustrated. Now, at this point, what can be done? I'm not sure, but we basically, essentially, de facto set up a no-fly zone in southern Syria just last week, to the surprise of the Russians, or else to the surprise of us. And there's going to be more of this. So we better, if we're not going to get the hell out of there completely, and that means get the hell out of the fight against ISIS too, which we're not going to do, we better have some kind of coherent policy of what we're willing to do, where we're willing to do it, under what circumstances, and who we're going to shoot if we're challenged, because we're not doing that now.
Let me just take play the devil's advocate role for a second. These guys know infinitely more, particularly Jim, about the situation in Syria and the conflict there, and have thought long and harder about what kind of role we should play. Let me just say, from 1998 to 2003, there was a civil war in Congo. About 5 million people died. Another 2 million people were displaced. We didn't get involved in any significant way. Between 83 and 2005, there was a civil war in Sudan. Couple million people died, another few million people were displaced. We didn't get involved in any particularly significant way. When Papa Assad crushed the Muslim Brotherhood and Islamists in Hama, killing 20,000 people, just massacring them right and left in the early, we basically didn't say boo because this wasn't the kind of thing that we did, because we didn't give a damn about what happened inside Syria. Why now we necessarily need to care so much more about Syria than we ever did in the past, when it was actually unified and hostile to us, than now that it's in turmoil and conflict? I see it as far more a reflection of our unfettered power in the world that allows us to care about things that we previously never cared about than a great strategic need for us to be involved. I have yet to see any significant plan by anybody that would actually make the situation on the ground in Syria any better. It would just insert us more directly involved in a major quagmire. And as heartless and as awful and as horrible as it sounds, there are times when figuring out which areas of the world are outside the liberal order and are going to be there for a while, and that you don't necessarily want to involve yourself with or need to involve yourself with, is the better part of valor. And that's the kind of question that it seems to me should be involved in our Syria discussions, rather than assuming that the only question is, what is the best particular way that we can make a slightly marginal gain in this situation by our direct involvement?
Strong statement. I here in front, two of you.
What are you?
No, I'm speaking.
I get the feeling, Gideon, that you would like
and
to,
keep it short.
I like to think you want to rename the Washington Institute the Washington Institute for Obscurity and Irrelevance, if you have your way. And I was very involved. I'm a former Pentagon person at DOD, and we were involved, to underscore Patrick's point, we were very involved in Yemen even before the Obama administration came in, because of the growth of the Al-Qaeda and Yemen problem, which, as Patrick underscored, became a huge issue. And secondly, oil still is critical in the Middle East, whatever you may think may happen 10 years from now. How much of Japan's oil comes from the Persian Gulf? And that's the answer to your question of why it's important. But my question or point is to Mike. One of the things that I was intimately involved in was this issue of counterinsurgency strategy. And what we saw in Iraq is how a conventional war-oriented military suddenly had to deal with an insurgency and had to relearn lessons that, you know, Ambassador Jeffrey knows well from Vietnam, had been once learned and had to be relearned again about how to fight counterinsurgency. And I agree with your point. At the time, we were worried about, well, we're going to lose track of conventional capabilities in dealing with Iran, which was a conventional concern because of air power, but also China, and now, of course, Russia. So, you know, certainly you aren't suggesting. Remember when Obama came in, the administration actually announced a big new strategy against counterinsurgency. And we were thinking, well, are we going to suddenly unlearn those lessons? So I'm assuming you're not saying unlearn the need for counterinsurgency,
no.
But let's remember that conventional and counterinsurgency capabilities remain important in the U.S. military in dealing with potential interventions, which we inevitably will have in the future.
Yeah, no, I agree with you, and really,
In the interest of keeping things moving, just I would agree with you for the most part, you know, on that. So I would just say we want to avoid major counterinsurgency campaigns where we are play the leading role. But we need to retain that competency, and we need to be able to transfer it to our allies, I would say.
Yeah. Sir.
Two questions. First, in the whole discussion about strategic interests, you mentioned energy. What about climate change? Of course, one of the problems are caused by climate change. And if you don't introduce that in your thinking, then you may also miss the point. The second is, why is Syria, why is the Congo not relevant and Syria is? Well, I would say that the Syrian refugee crisis is undermining stability in Europe, and that only should make it a point of thinking in American strategic thinking, which you don't see neither in Europe nor in the United States.
I'm just saying, I agree that, let's put it this way. One of the reasons that we did or were able to ignore the civil wars in Africa that caused so much human carnage was precisely because they didn't have significant knock-on effects out of region. And so the extent to which the Syrian conflict has a significant knock-on effects outside of region, including through refugee flows to Europe, is indeed a very significant argument. And I wasn't trying to suggest that we completely ignore Syria or do absolutely nothing, but I think that remembering that there were much larger and even more significant and tragic conflicts that we did nothing about, many of them, in our own recent lifetimes, is a useful thing because it puts the sort of perspective in a somewhat, you know, puts the conflict in a somewhat larger perspective. How exactly to deal with the refugee flows is an interesting question. I mean, the Europeans are showing that you can have very cynical ways of dealing with them as well. Paying Turkey to take them is an interesting side way of dealing with that without necessarily dealing with the, you know, root causes of the problem, as it were. But I agree that's a legitimate question. Climate change, I'm not sure how that plays into the Middle East policy, except possibly as a driver of it. But I think that sort of work on climate change is separate from the Middle East issues.
Yeah.
It's obviously something that
yeah.
should be taken.
First of all, I agree with you on the energy thing. And in one of my other lives, I go to a lot of energy conferences. And the International Energy Agency is very clear that by the middle of the next decade, the importance of Middle East oil for the entire global economy will rise, not fall. For the moment, because depending upon cost factors, how much we produce will have a temporary effect. But in the end, it's still going to be important, if not for our own imports. It's important for the imports, as you said, of Japan and others. In terms of Syria, I have to confess, despite the fact that my friends Fred Hoff and Robert Ford were totally focused on Syria. For a long time, I figured maybe along with Libya, this is something that, after my experiences in Iraq, isn't that important. But three things changed my mind. One is the refugee crisis. The second thing is the rise of ISIS, which was not only enabled to some degree, it was deliberately provoked by Assad's trying to turn this into a me versus terrorist thing. And thirdly, the intervention in Russia into the region, which in some respects is more dangerous than the intervention of Russia along its southern periphery in Georgia and Ukraine, as we have seen with the Turks and then last week with us. And so all of those things indicate Mike's point, which he's made twice, and I'm trying to flesh out his examples, that if you ignore the Middle East, because that's what we're trying to – we're not saying up here – let us go in there and we fix this place. You've heard from all of us variants of we don't fix this place. What we're trying to say is in a desperate defense of committing resources there, if you don't act, bad things happen. Twice we have not acted in the Middle East. Once is Syria. We can debate that. The other thing, and I was there on the ground watching all of the other things we were doing, the Clinton administration, after some initial hesitation and the problems in Somalia, got a whole series of interventions at least three quarters right. Haiti, Bosnia, Kosovo, the containment of Iran, and the containment of Iraq all the way up to Desert Fox in 1998. We on the ground in Kuwait laughed at the name, but it actually accomplished the mission of getting rid of Saddam's remnants of his WMD program. The one thing he didn't pay attention to in any serious way was that pesky al-Qaeda group that was hitting our ships and attacking our embassies. And we fired some cruise missiles at, a pharmaceutical factory in Sudan and some huts in Afghanistan. But there were so many other things to do, we didn't focus on that one, and look what happened. That's the problem with the Middle East.
In back.
Stanley Kober, I'm looking at a statement by the KRG Secretary General of Ministry of Peshmerga Affairs. He says, the Peshmerga have suffered over 1,600 dead in the last 2 years, over 8,600 wounded. And I wonder, how long can they sustain casualties of that magnitude and remain an effective fighting force? How big are they? Can they replace the casualties?
They're over 100,000. I was there in November counting their reserves and the people that they've got mobilized. They have a lot of people, but this is a significant set of casualties for them, and everybody feels that everybody knows somebody who's been killed or wounded.
If I could just add, this is one of the defining characteristics of the current wars that are going on in Iraq and Syria, in that both sides, at least in Syria and then in Iraq, ISIL, rely on cannon fodder from outside the region. ISIL has foreign fighters, although the numbers apparently are declining, and the Iranians rely on the kind of their foreign legion, which the first they relied on Hezbollah and Iraqi Shiite militias, and then they started, you know, recruiting Afghans and Pakistanis. So, you know, by and large, civil wars often fizzle out because of exhaustion and kind of the sense that both sides are kind of, you know, there's a stalemate. But if you still have cannon fodder or human kindling, which is being imported by both sides, it potentially extends the conflict and resources pouring in from outside the region. And that's one of the problems with this conflict. If we could cut that off, that would greatly facilitate, I think, the potential for a diplomatic settlement, at least in Syria, potentially. So.
Sir.
Michael Kutzig, who worked on the Middle East and the Department of Agriculture, talked about politics, military, but the situation has changed radically now with a very sharp decline in the price of oil. And so you have in Saudi Arabia, public sector spending will go down substantially. Their remittances, or as you call it, aid to Egypt, will go down substantially. That will cause a huge increase in unemployment and a labor problem, which is already there. So has anybody here considered a massive Marshall Plan for the Middle East by the United States, or something to help these people to stop the instability, which will continue? And the second point is only mentioned in the question and answer, not in your remarks. Nothing was said about Shia and Sunni, a 1,400-year-old war, which we got involved in, which is a never-ending war, apparently. And I don't know if I'm being totally idiotic here, but that's a major problem also in the region. So the question is, talk about that a little bit, and particularly about the economic side of it. And I don't know about the price of oil rising in the next 10 years. We've got all the oil we need, apparently, all the natural gas that we need. Some of the energy sources are changing. So I don't know if I agree with that. But we've got a major, major employment problem.
You're the economist. You want to...
Well, I think it's an interesting set of issues, but frankly, I would like to keep the conversation today focused on U.S. military engagement in the region. I would just simply say that there are lots of reasons why the region is unstable, but its economic problems are no greater than that of other areas. Yet its economic problems are no greater than that of other areas, but this is a region which has produced all kinds of military conflicts and political instabilities in face of those economic problems in a way that some other regions of the world have not. And that suggests to me that the security problems in this region certainly have the economic problems contribute to it substantially. But I think that there are other factors that make this area particularly uniquely unstable around the world. And this is an area that is prone to strong ideologies. You mentioned Sunni, Shia, not the only ones. And it's an area that's
prone to particularly vicious dictators. That's my take on it. Sir.
And then I think we'll make this our last question in deference to Gideon.
A couple of things. Before I was a militant, I worked in the Congress, just a side thing on that. You know, the comments here, I think, kind of American-centric. The Belgians and French were very much interested in the Congo, played some role there, just as the Australians did in Indonesia. I mean, you know, it's not all American-centered. But I have a broader question. The gentleman touched on about the Sunni-Shiite split. It seems, you know, Mike referred to the operational environment. Part of it seemed to be the Middle East is just a cultural issue of inability to compromise, to be pragmatic. I mean, Iraq's a good example of the, you know, Sunni-Shiite split. Do you see any likelihood that some of this may fade away even in a generation or so, or are these divisions and these cultural, I'll call them cultural weaknesses, even though it's politically correct, are going to remain, and basically it's a hopeless situation in terms of there ever developing a real democracy or semi-democracy?
The Sunni-Shia split has always been under the surface. It was one of the major contributing factors to the battling in the Levant in the 12th and 13th centuries between the Crusader kingdoms and various Fatimids and others. And so it has always been there, but it is often suppressed by other issues, and it has gained a lot of currency because of two things. One is the rise of these very extreme Sunni fanatic groups of a Wahhabist tendency, Salafist, Al-Qaeda, but particularly Al-Qaeda in Iraq, and ISIS, which is the son of Al-Qaeda in Iraq. Unlike Osama bin Laden, these people had a very explicit anti-Shia agenda. The other fuel for this, and we touched on this a bit, is Iran itself. The point is to quote Henry Kissinger, with Iran, you don't know whether it's a country or a cause. As a cause, its cause is, among other things, Shia Islam. As a country, it's a nationalist threat to the region. And I try to be careful because I don't want to portray Iran as solely a problem because of its Shia Islamic worldview. It has a Persian imperialistic worldview that is shared even by what we would consider the more secular people in Iran. My favorite is Hussein Mousavi, and the guy who had to flee to Princeton a few years ago, but he's now back with Rouhani and Zarif.
If I could just answer. First of all, I think it's important to note that culture is not immutable. Okay, so cultures have the ability to change either as a result of human action or as a result of events and developments. Now, we've seen, you know, if you want to find the silver lining in this you know, this human disaster that's going on in the Middle East, these series of, you know, civil wars and conflicts, is that war is often the midwife for cultural change. And so after World War I, British society and politics changed somewhat. The United States, American society after World War II changed in many ways, in many important ways. In the Middle East, after the 67 war, in terms of ideological change, you know, that marked the death of Pan-Arabism. The Iran-Iraq war caused the decline of Iranian kind of revolutionary zeal, the period of revolutionary zeal. So, and then if you look back in Europe and European history, the 30 Years' War led to the Treaty of Westphalia, which led to a kind of a more organized and more peaceable system of interstate relations. So is it possible that out of this maybe some good might come? I'm not optimistic, but it's possible. So I think it's rooted more in I'll just cite the work of Philip Carl Saltzman, who is an anthropologist, who has written about the importance of tribal values being woven into both Islam as well as Arab political culture as being the source of a lot of these problems. And it's rooted, you know, in the thinking of Ibn Khaldun, the 14th century, sociologist, talked about Asabiyya. So could that change? I mean, it's very deeply rooted, and that's the problem. and it's woven into the general culture. So I'm not optimistic, but you know, again, people can change. It's culture. It's not immutable.
By the way, on that note, may I point out that there were less than 100,000 Shia in Iraq in 1800, and may I point out that before we get going on about this age-old conflict between Sunni and Shia, Al-Azhar was founded as a Shia university by a Shia dynasty that ruled Egypt at the time. So our images of this conflict between Shia and Sunni dating back for centuries. Now, and on that note, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.